My pleasure to start the session with Gary Gorton, who's been a longtime supporter and contributor to these economic and monetary and financial history conferences. And so I'm looking forward to his talk today, and he's got 30 minutes, and then we'll have 10 minutes open for questions, comments, etc. So,
all right. Thank you very much, Warren. I think I've missed one of these only, attended all the others. I'm happy to see the core group again, and thanks to the organizers for giving me a chance to present some work in progress. This work is joint work with He Ping, one of my former students from about 15 years ago. Alexander Field, as many of you probably know, shows that the most productive period in US history was the Great Depression, basically. And he had a very famous paper in the AER saying this, which he later expanded into a book. And he discusses the innovation in manufacturing during this period as being the cause. Now, what we're gonna do is we're gonna look at bank innovation and during this period to determine the contribution of banking to economic growth. So we're gonna have a model of bank innovation, and we're going to relate that to growth accounting, and then we're gonna calibrate it, and we'll show you the contribution of banking. There is gonna be economic history in here though, don't worry. The existing literature that includes innovation in finance assumes that it's exogenous. So you assume that over time, more and more agents get access to credit markets. And then you see if you can match moments for, say, an economy like Thailand in the case of Rob Townsend. So this is the data that we're going to use. It doesn't look like much now, but those red dots are a couple years worth of work in bank archives. And the blue dots are from Federal Reserve surveys. So this is the maturity of business loans in the United States from about 1790 until 2019. And you can see the increase there around 1940 actually starts a little bit earlier. And this was the invention of the term loan. So this term loan was so notable that the NBER commissioned a book on the subject. And the authors did a survey about it. And there was a lot of talk about it, and it appears in several books because it was such an amazing change. Now, term loans require innovation on the part of banks because it requires that banks do credit analysis and design loan covenants. So in the earlier period, before the 30s, banks basically made three-month loans, right? This was the real bills doctrine. And they would roll over the loans, but there was no guarantee they would roll over the loans. So basically what they would do is they'd come to the end of 3 months and they'd say, well, you know, show us what you have. And if they liked it, they would roll over the loan. But the term loan, you know, you're not going to do that. You're going to lend for 5 years, for example, and you're not going to have an opportunity to go ask them what's happened after 3 months. So this was a major change in the technology of banking. And I'm going to focus on that today, although the same model is used for the later period where the innovation is securitization. So I'll show you one figure about that, but I'm not going to spend a lot of time on that one. We haven't actually finished that one yet. Okay, so I'm going to go through a model and I'm going to relate the model to growth accounting. And then we're going to calibrate this model. And then I'm going to look at the results for the Alexander Field period. And then I'll summarize with one figure the results for the later period. Okay, so we have an economy populated by a continuum of agents of measure L evolving over discrete time. Each agent runs a firm, and an agent has wealth W at date T, and he maximizes preferences with that particular form, subject to a budget constraint, where wealth has a distribution. So in equilibrium, we can easily calculate is consumption and savings. You just split the wealth. And so we can also calculate the amount of savings in the entire economy. Okay, so now there's two kinds of production technologies. There's manufacturing and non-manufacturing. Now in the book, the NBER book, they do a survey, and most of the term loans are going to manufacturing, but not exclusively. But the data that are available only divide between manufacturing, non-manufacturing, and farming. So manufacturing employs the innovative technology, and it's also has a random output. With probability PIT, they get F of K, and otherwise they get zero. The non-manufacturing firms just employ what we call the regular technology, and it's not stochastic. You just get ANK, so it's an AK technology. And this probability of success in outputs independent of everything, so we don't have to worry about that. So PIT is private information for the firm. So we're going to think of it as a type. And we're going to assume the firm's type updates every tau periods. It's going to turn out that we can drop these little t subscripts because there's nothing really linking periods here. So firm I has to decide whether to take a long-term loan, tau upper bar, for manufacturing, or a short-term loan for the non-manufacturing. And if the firm applies for short-term borrowing, the non-manufacturing firm N, its tau period payoff will be the profit function at the bottom. So notice that what that says is that the non-manufacturing firm borrows for tau lower bar, but he rolls it over. Every 3 months, for example, he starts production again. And we're doing that so that it matches tau upper bar. Okay, so how many times is the non-manufacturing firm going to run the technology? Well, it's tau upper bar divided by tau lower bar. Okay. And then at the end, he's going to have to pay back the loan. Here's how we're going to model bank innovation. Banks now, unlike before, have a technology to screen out lambda portion of the long-term manufacturing investment with zero output, while not making any mistakes on those with a positive return. So what the bank can do is, you know, ex ante, it can determine whether you're going to get zero or not. And if you're going to get zero, then it has the ability to rule out, to reject the loan applications from a fraction of firms that are going to get zero. And if the firm gets a long-term loan, then it's going to invest for tau upper bar periods. And with probability PIT, it's going to be successful in getting some output. And with probability 1 minus P times lambda, the probability that you're ruled out, you get pi N. I think it's screen out 1 minus lambda. So the default probability based on these little equations is given by this expression for DIT. So there's going to be a cutoff type P star above which a firm will apply for a long-term loan for the bank if it's profitable to be in manufacturing. So assume banks' cost of funds is R, and in equilibrium, these risk-neutral banks earn zero profits. And from this, with some substitution, we can get this tau hat guy, which we're gonna calibrate, we're gonna estimate in a minute. So what we have is we have, from the data from the archives, we have tau hats, right? We have tau hats. And what we're gonna need to do is determine tau upper bar, right? So we're going to set tau lower bar to 3 months, and then we're going to find out what tau upper bar is. And the tau hat is the average of the two. So remember, the archival data is the average maturity to of a business loan to banks. So we know tau hat, we don't know tau upper bar. Okay, so in equilibrium, the total amount of investment aggregates manufacturing projects and non-manufacturing projects. And so for a manufacturing project, the firm is going to pick K, the amount of capital, which is going to be the size of the loan, and they have a first order condition. And we're going to assume that it's AK as before, and we can solve for the optimal level of K. Okay. So, you know, there's a proof of equilibrium and so on in the paper, but I'm not going to go into that. Now, we from this little model, we can write out total output. Total output is that expression at the top. And you can see the total output has the default probabilities in there. And we can write the growth rate of total output in the middle equation. So that's the, this is the growth accounting equation, and you see there's five factors. There's the change in TFP in manufacturing, AM, change in TFP in AN, the change in capital for the two guys, and the change in labor. And then there's this critical piece, the change in lambda. Okay, the change in lambda. So what's appearing here that's new is that last term, the change in lambda. Now, the bottom equation is a first order Taylor expansion of the middle equation. And we, you know, we don't use Cobb-Douglas production here. We don't really have a functional form for production. And so what we're gonna have to do is we're gonna have to numerically evaluate these partial derivatives, okay, when we get to that part. Okay, so the two things we need and we're going to calibrate are P star and lambda. And we can write those as follows in terms of other exogenous factors, but there's not really a lot of other exogenous factors, but we need to know P star and lambda. So you can see it appears in both equations. And the left-hand side of the expectation is the expected default for the firms who went into manufacturing, right? And then you see in both integrals, the lower bound is P star. Okay, so how are we gonna do this? Well, so let's assume the cost of funds is R, and we're gonna have data for that. And equilibriums make banks make zero profits, which gives us this equation in the middle. And so we're going to calibrate that equation so that we can determine the expected default probability.
Somebody needs to mute.
Yeah, that's me. Hey, somebody's delivering something and that sets them up. So we can run that regression there to determine the upper bound of the loans, right? Because we know T hat from the data, and we set T lower bar to 1 month. And so the thing that we need to do is find a tau upper bar, okay? And then from that, we can estimate, that is calibrate, the default risk, assuming a distribution, and we're gonna assume it has a uniform distribution. So then I can rewrite these things, assuming the uniform distribution. And the calibration we're going to do is given there at the bottom. We're going to pick all those parameters to minimize the errors which I've added to the two equations. Now, there's a lot going on because, in the context that we're interested in, we need to evaluate the Taylor expansion. So we need all those lambdas for each year because we're going to calculate this for each year, right? We're not matching moments. We're going to try to match the path of the growth rates for GDP. Okay. And actually, it's very powerful to not have a production function, because then we can evaluate these partial derivatives at every point, and it basically creates a smooth function. Okay, so we also need A's, TFP. We need TFP, and so we have this simple output, and we're going to determine alpha, and then we'll go back and calculate AM and AN. So there's a little bit more to it than that, but that's suffice. Okay, so let me before I show you some results, let me kind of summarize what we're doing here. We have a model of bank innovation with an unobserved parameter lambda. And we know that firms can choose to be in manufacturing or not in manufacturing. And that's going to be determined by P star. So in a simple growth accounting context, we can calculate the path of and calculate each of these factors for every year, okay, from the Taylor expansion. Now, usually people who are in this area do second order expansion as well, but for our model's too complicated for that. It may not seem complicated, but believe me, it is complicated. Okay, so let me show you some results. Okay, so here's the results year by year for each factor: TFP in manufacturing, TFP in non-manufacturing, total capital, total labor, and lambda. Okay, and at the bottom are the averages. So we calculate the contribution of lambda to be 33.5%. Now, that to us that seemed very high, but Jeremy Greenwood, one of my old student buddies from Rochester, has a model where there's no innovation in banking, but he includes a Townsend debt model in the economy. And the contribution of bank to of the banking sector he gets is similar to this number. Okay. So this is the contribution to real output. So we have to match real output, so we get a negative number there. Here's the contribution to estimated output. So this table uses the actual output growth on the left, and this table uses the estimated output growth on the left, and it's a little bit lower. So we can also look at, say, the trend for lambda. So remember, this you can think of lambda as the amount of information that's being produced. And this is the period where the term loan is being invented. And you can see that at the start of the 30s, lambda starts to go up, which is what we would expect if it's consistent with the term loan, right? So this lambda, you know, is roughly, you know, better credit analysis, better information production, and better covenant design. So it's the model comes up with an expression or a graph of lambda from the data that's kind of consistent with what's going on with field. And it's consistent with P star. So as more information is being produced, the technology is improving, more firms are choosing to go in the manufacturing sector because P star is going down. Okay. So these were the two variables that were sort of the linchpin of the whole thing. And they have quite reasonable pictures. Okay. Here's Alexander Field. TFP in manufacturing is going up, right? So we have a little estimation of alpha, but this comes from the model. And so here's the result. The result is that we do pretty well. Orange is the real path of growth rates. And blue is the model path of growth rates for GDP, okay? So, you know, in this calibration land, you know, you have to sort of, you know, decide for yourself how, whether that's a good fit or not a good fit. Now, the other major innovation in this period, 1980 to 2017, that's the period over which we have the Fed survey data on the maturity of business loans. This was another period of innovation, and we can do the same thing as we did before, with the same data. Everything's the same, almost, and we get this picture. So we don't do as well so far. I mean, one of the problems is that we don't have the best capital data. We're refining this to see this period. It's not manufacturing and non-manufacturing. That's one of the big problems. In the earlier period, you have manufacturing and non-manufacturing. In this period, you know, manufacturing is very small, and so we need to categorize firms into different sectors where we think that there's longer maturity loans and so on. So we have a way of doing that, but I can't show you the picture of that yet. So this one looks a little bit choppy. So the conclusion is banks are central to economic growth. And that's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Gary. I see no questions in the chat. So I will just, if people want to kind of raise their hand. Well, can't see everybody. If we stop screen sharing, I could see everyone. You could raise your hand.
Okay, sorry. There we go.
There's everybody. Are there questions? Michael?
I had a question. This is Jonathan Rose. But Gary, I was just wondering, when you think about the maturity extension of loans the banks offered, are they taking some business away from the bond market? Which would be a place to get a term loan before? And how do you think about that substitution when thinking about sort of like how banks are adding to the, you know, the productivity of the economy?
So there weren't term loans before. Term loans, you know, kind of almost suddenly appear. In the NBER book, the authors enumerate like 7 reasons why the term loans appeared when they did appear. One of the reasons is that it's costlier to issue bonds because now you have the SEC and all that. But they list a lot of reasons, and all of them seem vaguely, you know, probably true to some extent. But I don't see anything definitive that can be pointed to. And they, in their survey, they asked about it, and I think that part didn't even make it into the book. So we don't really have anything to say about where the invention came from, but it was quite dramatic.
Okay. Mark Carlson, do you want to go with your question? I see your hands up.
Sure. I was going to ask, so I think in some of the readings I've done around this time suggest that there's also either now, then or just before, there had been a shift toward funding that's sort of not for a particular purpose. So like before, there had been sort of, you know, the acceptances and bills of exchange and financing for trade finance. Then there's been, during this period, there's a shift towards people being this sort of commercial paper and even short-term financing that is not for a particular purpose, but could be just used for general corporate purposes. Is that, you see, so would that sort of connect to this and this be sort of a next extension of that? Or would you view that as a different part of the financial developments?
So the red dots come from, you know, loan records in archives of banks. And, you know, banks aren't holding mortgages. They're not making mortgages at this period. It comes later. And the maturity of mortgages in any case was much lower. But the red dots are all business loans. So that would include short maturity stuff. And the weighted average is going up there at, towards the end of the 30s, starting in like 1934. So that's everything that businesses are getting. So that's all I can tell you, really.
Mm-hmm. Mark Flandreau?
Yeah. Can you, thanks so much, Gary. It's a thought-provoking piece. The stand-up British, the story of the maturity of loans in the 19th century is that they looked short, but they were long. So in other words, there was an understanding that they were revolving. So this is something that has been discussed a lot as part of precisely the finance and growth debate, because when German banks appear and start formally contracting longer term, if I understand correctly, in the late 19th century, the British banks don't do that. And that could be a reason for the climacteric blah, blah, blah. But again, the counter argument has been, well, but in fact, they look short, but they're long. So there was this as a question I had. And another one was, how about actually the early long-term securitized loans like bonds, right? So there are lots of corporate loans that have long maturities that appear, for instance, to fund railways. And I was thinking maybe, I mean, like that could be actually be used by your theory in that maybe the story is that the securitization before they are banks only takes place in industries where there's a form of monitoring and transparency that enable to actually structure and float the bonds, right? So for instance, you can go and measure railways. You can, like the first rating books for railway bonds, that's exactly what they were doing. They were saying, this is how it operates. They would give you all that kind of physical, so to speak, information about what was going on. Now, of course, for a more complex technology, especially if it's a new technology, I can see how your argument about banks become particularly important, right? And so how you fund, in fact, a wave of industrial revolution, given that you cannot float bonds due to the information asymmetries. So essentially, I had these two questions. Did you have any thought about the trick of maturity, apparent and actual? And
The anecdotal evidence that's mentioned in books is exactly this idea that they were revolving, essentially, right? That you could sort of count on having your three-month loan renewed unless something bad happened.
Yeah. My wife was a commercial banker, and they were called evergreen loans.
Evergreen loans.
they never died.
But the other thing that you can read about from the banking literature of the time is all this discussion of needing to learn about longer term credit analysis and covenant design. So once you say, well, we're not going to just roll it. What we're going to do is give you a 5-year loan, but that's just a different animal. So we have to design the loan contract differently. The other thing is that there were certain industries did have bonds for sure, like railroads, but the industries that I think are in the survey of the NBER that are preponderantly getting longer term loans is manufacturing. It's the companies that seem like they turn into the old CIO union companies, those kind of companies. But so we don't really know enough about other than that, who the clientele was that was borrowing with term loans.
Okay. Michael Bordo. You need to go off mute.
Sorry. Gary, let's go back to just the U.S. financial history. And maybe if Dick Silla here, he might ask this question. But the U.S. always had a fairly crummy banking system, if I can say that. I mean, it had unit banks and there were all these restrictions. Canada didn't, okay, but the U.S. did very well, and it was, and there really was financial intermediation, and the growth was in the non-bank financial intermediary sector. So you had shadow banks, you had securities. So what I'm wondering about is if you didn't let take the counterfactual that this didn't happen, okay. Was that saying that the U.S. wouldn't have grown as much as it did? It seems to me that most of the growth of finance was in the past coming from the non-bank financial investment, financial intermediary side of the economy. And I can't see that would have changed.
Well, I mean, I don't have a quantitative answer to your question. So I usually think of the period after deposit insurance as being kind of a quiet period. I don't know how big the whole financial landscape was different before, the Great Depression, but I don't know how much, I don't know the answer to your counterfactual, but you probably have a better sense of it than I do.
Gary?
Yeah.
Richardson, sorry.
Hey, Gary, so, I think this is a fascinating project. Jonathan kind of asked one of my first questions. I'm going to rephrase that and then make a suggestion. Before the 1930s, before this expansion of term loans, right, it looks like businesses that were borrowing from banks were borrowing for about, the same length of time, but they had a relationship that allowed these, you to borrow a long time for a kind of medium or longer term, even though you had a short-term contract. And then the banks are shifting, right, in the 1940s to longer term contracts. So it's, it's not that firms couldn't borrow kind of medium term, 5 to 10 years before, but they were doing this under different mechanisms. So it'd be, it might be interesting, and this is what Jonathan talked about with the bond market, right? So there were a lot of manufacturers that issued bonds, even kind of smaller sized ones. And now a lot of that action that was in the bond market or in relationship lending shifts to term loans. And so it'd be interesting to try to say, why do the differential frictions, why might they be triggering this increase in business innovation? It's not clear to me that the quantity of medium-term lending is changing rather than just the mechanism. And I think that's what Jonathan was saying. I'd say, now thinking about Jonathan, and this is my idea, is that there's an area where the nature of lending in the US economy and financial system changes really dramatically in the 1930s, from very short-term loans that are rolled over to very, very long-term amortizing loans, right? And this is in housing and housing finance. So I think it would be interesting to take your model and kind of rejigger it and apply it in, another paper, which maybe you could write, co-author with Jonathan, because he's the expert on housing, big expert on housing finance. And say, how does the change in the structure of home financing, which is really dramatic and really unprecedented, how is that going to affect investment in housing infrastructure and other things? Because we know there's a huge change in the structure of US housing that's going to come out starting in the mid 40s and have a huge impact on the structure of our society and the productivity of our economy through to the 1960s and 70s, with the rise of the suburbs. So it seemed that that's kind of a parallel project, to look at the changing structure of home financing and the lengthening of the term of maturity there.
I haven't thought about that. I mean, the linchpin in terms of data here was the maturity data. And remember all the other things, we have data on. We have data on manufacturing output, employment, capital. So there's, the 30s the period that Field studied, we actually do have pretty decent data. I mean, the earlier period is simpler compared to the later period. The later period, manufacturing small, so we're not sure who's getting the loans, and the data is better, but everything's more complicated. So maybe it's true in the housing sector, I don't know, but you got to get the data.
Okay. Jonathan will have the data, so he's the guy to talk about.
Okay, Chris Cotter.
So my question, I guess, is just centered around your sense of why this shift kind of happened when it did, because I guess this is a story of, an increase in term loans, and then kind of out of necessity, banks have to kind of innovate and figure out how to better evaluate these longer term loans. But it seems like, you know, the middle of the Great Depression is a particularly difficult time to shift from, you know, we can reevaluate this every 3 months to, you know, we have to look 5 years out and make a decision. And so I guess you alluded to some, you know, list of multiple reasons why term loans are kind of arising, but kind of why this banking innovation is occurring, you know, at this particular point.
Well, again, I don't know the answer. I mean, I think my intuition is that Field's discovery, as I think of it, tells us that this was a very intensely innovative time. Banking is an industry, like steel industry. And so, you know, they were innovating as well. So why was there this burst of innovation during the Great Depression? That's, you know, kind of a more general question. Our question is narrower. There's a million growth models that are calibrated that don't have financial sectors and they don't have banks. And the ones that do have very mechanical banks. So our question is it in the data that the growth in the banking sector is important for economic growth? That's the question we focused on. I wish I knew the answer to the question you're asking, but I think the authors of the NBER book thought a lot about this. You know, they had a lot of data that they got from the survey, but they didn't really have an answer either. And I think that's why they give seven reasons. I mean, if we could have answered that, we would have.
Okay, Steve Quinn.
Yeah, hi, Gary. Hi. I suppose my question is about one of those possible seven, because of course it also coincides with FDIC, and I know you've written a lot on that. But it strikes me as a real, one of the other changes going on this era was maybe banks felt much freer to tie on to longer term debt just because they had deposit insurance now.
That's one of the reasons that the NBER authors list. They list that as very important. They list the costs of bond issuance very important because of the SEC, the new SEC. And then they have five others. And they all seem kind of plausible, but I agree with you. FDIC insurance would seem to me to be pretty important.
Yeah. Are there any other questions? With that, I think we should all thank Gary. Very provocative, learned a lot.
Well, thank you. And,
I think we will go for a break and we reconvene at 2:20.
That's right. We'll see you in 12 minutes. I guess we'll have a whole 12 minutes this time.
Okay.
All right.
Thanks, Gary.
Hey, Gary, before you go.
Yeah.
You know the work by Tom Nicholas about the bubble, you know, 1920s bubble, and how what was going on was there were a lot of patents being generated.
Yeah.
Then the distress of some sort comes along, and those kind of the story I would tell maybe to try out in you is those patents were things that were not able to be exploited once the economic distress occurred. That kind of time horizon to realization was expanded. And so, you know, maybe people were thinking, well, we just have to get longer term money to invest in things that we believe are good, are very profitable longer term, but the horizon over which those innovations could be realized people might not be buying washing machines for a few years or something like that. You know, so that might be tied into the innovation story a bit as well.
Yeah, I mean, again, that's a data problem. I mean, if you had asked me before I read Alexander Fields' article, I would have said that the 20s was the most innovative period, right? There was this huge credit boom and there was a lot of innovation. That's the period that it's really well documented. And a lot of that has to do with, you know, not new machines, but rearrangements of machines.
Yeah, lots of patents.
Yeah. So, but, you know, then with Fields' work, it turns out to be the 30s. But then, you know, even in Fields' book, I mean, he doesn't have, you know, kind of hard evidence about, you know, exactly which, you know, I mean, everybody's innovating, but it's hard to pin down what is really contributing to TFP growth, right? So there's this big disconnect between reading, you know, this kind of vague but probably correct literature and then mapping it into numbers.
Gary, let me get back to what I'm saying was, it's like my counterfactual is, let's say the banks weren't there or they didn't do that. Would the U.S. economy have grown slower or would we have had other financial intermediation? Okay.
That's, yeah, I mean, the market would have supplied.
Yeah, that's what I mean. Okay. That's my...
I mean, but the problem is, are you just going to like magically get rid of all the banks?
Because no.
It's taken a while for the other guys to really show up.
It's just a way of, when you say the banks contributed this much, okay, that's assuming that if they weren't there, it wouldn't have been there. And so you have to, that's what I'm getting at. So what would have been the marginal contribution if you didn't have the substitution that could have taken the place of the banks? That'd be a much smaller number.
Yeah. Let me try to restate your counterfactual, which is, suppose that they had not lengthened the term of the loans. How much slower would U.S. growth have been during that period?
Yeah. All right.
Yeah. I mean, that's a great question. The thing is, we this is not a model where we can do counterfactuals very persuasively, right? I mean, we I have this loan maturity data. And I have a model. It doesn't say that it's banks, by the way. It just says there's a technology, right? The whole thing about Lambda is a technology. I called it banks because we have in mind banks because the data about the loans is from banks. But, you know, literally speaking in the model, it could be interpreted as, you know, a broader set of institutions. But
Okay. But
the thing that's pinning it down is the loan data from the archives, right? So I can't do a counterfactual. I wish I could, but
But you kept calling it lengthening the term structure. That's why I think where Michael and I, well, at least where I would be coming
right.
From.
So like I'm taking it from. I mean, I've read Alex Fields' work, and I talk to him a lot. So let's take that as given. So there would have been a demand for the financing for these patents and to produce these innovations.
Yeah.
Okay. So that's the forcing variable. It's the innovation which didn't come from banking. So banking, in a sense, filled the gap and financed it, and may have led to more growth than otherwise would have occurred. But it would have occurred. It would have been financed somehow because we'd already in the past financed these things.
So I'm not sure that, you know, I mean, first of all, it could have been that the banks innovated and so that allowed all the other innovation to occur. I mean, if you're if you're manufacturing and you have long-term stuff on your asset side, you know, it makes more sense to have match your duration match. So, you know, it's this idea that the banks are a veil that we're trying to push back against, right?
Yeah.
So, and I was surprised by the size of the contribution. I was so happy to read Greenwood's paper, but you could say, well, suppose the steel companies were taken away. Wouldn't somebody have thought of, you know, concrete or something to
replace? Yeah, no, but that's, yeah, of course.
I think you're right that banks, you know, if there's an opportunity to innovate, the banks will, or somebody will come in and try to do it. I want to go back in history, and I know it's not as major as what you're talking about, but you know, I keep thinking of the completion of the Erie Canal And prior to that, there's almost no banks in that part of New York. There's one in Albany, maybe one in Buffalo. And very soon after that's there, you find banks scattered all the way along this canal about, you know, every 30, 40 miles.
Well, wasn't the canal financed by the government?
It was financed. It didn't have to do with financing. In my view, what it had to do with was the need to fund trade along the way. And all of a sudden, people located along the canal had opportunities right. to send goods. But, you know, and so the banks were there to help fund the trade. So it isn't, you know, funding capital, but, you know, here's an opportunity to make some profit, set up a bank, fund the trade, make money.
And yeah, but I mean, the implication is that the trade wouldn't have happened without the bank. Maybe the bank started first and then funded.
Actually, they came in after the canal was completed.
Yeah.
But so, I mean, this is the whole, you know, which came first, finance or trade question.
So that, again, I mean, it's more ambitious than we are to answer that. I mean, you know, these are great questions, but
All I was trying to do was support your argument that if there's some kind of innovation opens up some opportunity, that someone will step in and try to finance that opportunity. Yeah,
that's all I was saying.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, I can't argue with that.
Anyway.
Okay.
Well, thanks, Gary. It was great. Thanks. Yeah,
thank you, Gary. Thanks again.
Yeah.